الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, his entire household and all his companions. We ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to bless them all and to bless every single one of us and to make us from amongst those who achieve forgiveness. These are the last few nights of the month of Ramadan. As we just heard this evening, the odd night or the first of the odd nights of the month of Ramadan, and it's up to us, inshallah, to make an effort to achieve the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters in Islam, when we say we are Muslim, we are not allowed to do that which would earn the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, claiming that this is permissible. So when a person commits a sin and they know it is a sin, they stand a far greater chance of earning the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than a person who commits a sin trying to justify that it is actually not a sin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May He make us conscious of our deeds. And may He make us from those who realize the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Allah has made it very clear in the Quran that it is not up to a person who claims to believe that when Allah and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam have declared something or have instructed something, that they feel in their hearts that they still have a choice about it. If we are believers, as soon as we hear the instruction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we will feel in our hearts that we do not have a choice about it, we must surrender. That is the true believer. So Allah says, Surah Al-Ahzab, verse number 36,
وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ.
الله أكبر. It is not for a believing male or female that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have instructed something that they feel that they still have a choice regarding that instruction. No. True believers feel that they must surrender. Even if the weakness of an individual makes them engage in something sinful, the fact that they recognize that it is a sin is, inshallah, better than a person who goes out to justify their wrongdoing and say there's nothing wrong with it. This is something we must understand. And this is actually the whole concept of surrendering to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent for us to obey the instruction that he has come with. And what is the point of us claiming to be believers, claiming to be followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we don't actually follow? If we move on, the same surah, Surah Al-Ahzab, verse number 70, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us once again regarding our tongues. And He's worded it so beautifully.
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا.
O you who believe, be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and utter only that which is upright. Only speak that which is sadid. Sadid means straight. That which is the truth. That which is upright, that which is free from any form of vulgarity and abuse, that which will result in a person's Jannah and paradise or goodness in this world as well as the next. When we speak that which is truthful, when we are careful of how we say what we want to say, then by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ. Your deeds that you've been engaging in, He will purify them or He will make them correct or good. Good enough to be accepted by Allah. And why this is the case? There are so many examples or explanations. One of them is, when we've done a lot of good deeds, but we're not bothered about what we say, we lie, we cheat, we deceive, we slander, we spread rumor, we engage in very bad words with our mouths, we scream and yell, we abuse people. In that case, all the acts of worship we've engaged in shall be wasted because they will be paid as a payment to those whom we have wronged with our tongue.
This is why we need to be careful. If we are careful with what we say, then our deeds that we engage in, we will protect them. We will look after them. When we come on the day of judgment, we won't have to pay them to anyone and give them as a penalty. So this is why Allah says, when you are careful regarding what comes out from your mouth, we will make your other deeds, inshallah, we will make your other deeds good enough or pure or acceptable, and we will forgive your sins. And he ends the verses by saying, whoever follows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger, they have indeed succeeded. They are victorious in a very, very great way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success and victory. The next surah is named as Surah Saba. It is named Surah Saba. Saba meaning Sheba. Sheba is a place. I'm sure we've all heard of the Queen of Sheba. At the time of Musa, Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, the lady who was there, commonly known as Bilqis, and the fact that she was the leader and so on of a nation, that place known as Saba in the southern part of the Arabian Peninsula, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has named a surah after it. And if you look carefully at the story of that particular place in the surah, you will learn a lot. Let's take a quick look at it. They were granted so much in terms of crop, and the rain they had was so good, and the gardens were plush, they were green, they really bore lots of fruit, and they had so much in terms of not only beauty, but even what to eat and what they had. Allah had blessed them with so much, but their sin was one thing. Ingratitude, that's all. Ingratitude. They were not grateful of what Allah had bestowed upon them. So Allah gives us, we'd better be grateful by the will of Allah. Search for the gifts of Allah upon you. It is important for us to look into our lives and ask ourselves, what are the gifts of Allah upon me? I've got my eyes, I've got my nose, I've got my hair, mashallah, I've got, alhamdulillah, you know, so many other gifts of Allah, the ears we have, the hands we can walk. This is not even starting, but Allah's bestowed us with wealth. We've got food, we've got air, we've got clothing, we've got shoes, we've got a little dwelling, whether it's rented or whether we own it. We've got so much. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. The weakness with us, we concentrate on the few things that Allah has chosen not to give us. And can I tell you, every one of us, there has to be certain things we are not given as a test. So you are not given some things, someone else is not given a few different things. So don't become upset because of what you are not given, because there are others who have not been given what you have. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us happy people who really can concentrate on positives. So Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ. Verse number 15, Surah Saba. جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينٍ وَشِمَالٍ كُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لَهُ بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ وَرَبٌّ غَفُورٌ. Allah says, in Saba, there is an example for you to learn in their dwellings. What is the example? Allah says, they had two gardens. They had lots and lots of produce, and Allah gave them the gardens that were, mashallah, watered with beautiful rain, just enough. And as it came down, mashallah, the fruit and the crop came up. Allah told them, you know what? Just be thankful for what your Rabb has given you. Indeed, He is most forgiving. And Allah says, فَأَعْرَضُوا. They turned away. They did not listen to just that much. فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ. So we sent them a flood. We sent them the floods that came through and wiped out whatever they had. And after that, whatever rain they had resulted in the produce becoming rotten, and it was not fit for consumption. Remember, rain is a gift of Allah. Too much of it is a problem. Too little of it is a problem. So Allah gives exactly enough, the right amount of rain, and that is a blessing of Allah. May He grant us just enough for us. Allahu Akbar. So Allah says, ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَّا الْكَفُورُ. That is the recompense because of their ingratitude. And do we give such a recompense to any besides those who are ingratitude? Which means who are ungrateful. Which means if anyone shows ingratitude, they are the ones who will achieve a similar punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May we be from amongst those who can realize. Like I said, search. Without searching, you won't pick up the gifts of Allah. You need to look for them. You need to hunt for them in your life. Ask Allah, what is it I have? And see, you will have a whole list, and that list will not deplete until the day you die. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us ease and goodness. Ameen. And this is made mention of in the next few verses where people were defying the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and even their messengers. But when it comes to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the kuffar of Quraysh used to ask him, this promise of Allah, when is it going to come? You're telling us that Allah is going to do this and do that. When is it coming? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds, verse number 29 of Surah Saba, وَيَقُولُونَ مَتَى هَذَا الْوَعْدُ إِن كُنتُمْ صَادِقِينَ They say, when is this promised time of the punishment? If you are truthful, we want to know. So Allah responds in a powerful way, very powerful way. He says, verse number 30 of Surah Saba, قُلْ tell them,
قُلْ لَكُمْ مِيعَادُ يَوْمٍ لَا تَسْتَأْخِرُونَ عَنْهُ سَاعَةً وَلَا تَسْتَقْدِمُونَ
You have an appointed time. You have been given an appointed time for that. It will not be brought forward by a minute, nor will it be delayed by a moment. Allah says the fixed time is there. We have given you that appointed time. When the punishment comes, nothing will stop it. May Allah bless us all. The lesson we have to learn from this, brothers and sisters, Allah gives us chances, but He knows when those chances are going to come to an end. So every time you need to know, you have a fixed number of chances, a fixed number of days or time, a fixed number of time that you have been given to turn to Allah. After which, the punishment will start coming one after the other. So if you've heard, for example, reminders, maybe in your destiny, you were allowed to hear 23,525 reminders before the punishment descends. Who knows? We might have already clocked 23,000. May Allah protect us. It's being ticked off. Did you send a reminder? Yes. Another reminder? Yes. Did he turn? No, he didn't. Another reminder? Yes. Did he turn? No, he didn't. Another reminder? Did she turn? No, she didn't. Has she dressed appropriately? No, she didn't. Another reminder? Okay. Did she hear the radio program? Yes. Did she attend that talk? Yes. Has she heard that CD? Yes. All these are reminders. Has she read that book? Yes. Did it cross her eyes? Yes. Did she see those people? Did he see them? Yes. Everything ticked. After that, two more left. Has that happened? Yes. Before the last one comes, let's turn, mashallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a turning point. We don't want, really, we don't. We cannot afford to let the last one come. Believe me, we can't. We need to turn. It's being ticked off. Right now, as we are speaking, there are ticks next to our name. This is being given. That's why what came to your ears was never meant to miss you. It's supposed to come to your ears. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So in Surah Fatir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us in verse number 6,
إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًّا إِنَّمَا يَدْعُوا حِزْبَهُ لِيَكُونُوا مِنْ أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ
Indeed, shaitan is your declared enemy. So consider him an enemy. For indeed, he calls his group towards the punishment of the fire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. A lot of us, we know that shaitan, he's planning and he's trying and he tries to divert us. But we don't consider him an enemy because we allow ourselves to get diverted. You know shaitan makes you sleep over Fajr. Well, if you've slept over Fajr for one day, then you cannot be planning to sleep over Fajr for the next day because you would know that subhanallah, this shaitan has come to me in this direction. Let me get up. And let me make sure I don't allow him in. If a thief comes into your house from that window, tomorrow morning there'll be a guard standing in that window. Do you agree? Why? Because you know I don't want him to come back from here. But shaitan makes us commit adultery and we do it again and again and again. Where's the guard? Allahu Akbar. Shaitan makes us engage in pornography and we do it again and again and again. In fact, we become so much that shaitan goes away, but we're still with that pawn. May Allah protect us. Really? Now he's gone to someone else and we're still engaging in it. And these are live examples. Sometimes good people have hidden sins that really are a disaster. May Allah not expose us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May He make us from amongst those who can turn. My brothers and sisters, you know the devil is your enemy. When he comes in your direction, make sure that you do not allow him to repeat the same thing again. He is a criminal. He's taking away from you something more valuable than anything material you own. Yet, if something valuable was to be stolen from you, you would do something about it. If your Rolls Royce was stolen, the following time you bought a vehicle, a Range Rover or whatever it was, you would make sure you have vehicle tracking in it. You've got a state-of-the-art alarm. Nowadays, they've got a new alarm which has cameras around the vehicle, which is 24/7 CCTV. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Yes, it's there, no joke. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. I'm just thinking, don't come and ask me for it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness. So Allah says, verse number 15,
Ya ayyuha an-nasu antumul fuqara'u ila Allah.
People, you are the ones who are totally dependent on Allah. For everything, you depend on your maker. Don't forget that. Allah says, you are in absolute need of Allah. Oh man, you are in complete need of Allah. Fuqara, faqir is a person who has nothing. So we have nothing besides that which Allah has provided for us. Allahu Akbar. This is why in another narration, Allah says, and this is a narration of a hadith Qudsi, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kullukum arin illa man kasawtuhu. Every one of you is naked besides those whom I have clothed. So ask from me and I will clothe you. Every one of you is hungry besides those whom I have granted food to. So ask me and I will give you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Sometimes people are wearing the best of clothing, but they think that this clothing is enough for them. No, sometimes we become people who are ashamed of walking out because Allah has exposed our shamelessness, yet we are clothed with proper clothing. Allahu Akbar. So it's not only to do with what you wear, it's to do with the type of a person you are. Beautify yourself with good character and conduct and with obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah bless us and grant us ease. So Allah says,
Wallahu huwa al-ghaniyyu al-hamid.
You need to know Allah is absolutely independent of you. He needs nothing from you. He doesn't need your worship, nor does he need the praise that you engage in. It will only benefit you. If you praise Allah, the benefit is yours. If you engage in salah, the benefit is yours. If you want to turn away, you're still going to return to Allah without anything. Just like the day you were made. You will return to Allah, no money, no meaning nothing, absolutely nothing. Not even the clothing that you're wearing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and help us prepare for the day we meet him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he is totally independent. And then he shows his power. Verse number 16, Surah Fatir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
إِن يَشَأْ يُذْهِبِكُمْ وَيَأْتِ بِخَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ وَمَا ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِعَزِيزٍ.
If he wants, he can do away with you and replace you with others. And that's not difficult for him. Not at all. He can replace people. He has replaced people. Aren't we people who have come about after other generations who are gone before us? Allah says, if we want, we can take you away now, or we will take you away as time passes. There will come a time when a whole generation will change. Those who were before will not even be known. I can ask you a question. How many of us here can name 20 people who lived in this city 200 years ago? Very few of us. What are the chances of me and you being named 200 years after today by people who might sit in the same spot in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The chances are almost nil. That's the reality. Almost nil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. We still think we're a big deal and we can get away with transgressing against the one whom, when we get into the grave, it's only his mercy that can make that journey easy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then gives us some really, really heartwarming verses. He says, subhanallah, that there is a business that people engage in. There is a certain type of a business that people engage in that will never deplete. The reward of it, the profit of it will keep on coming. It will not stop. What is that business? Listen, Allah says, verse number 29, same surah, Surah Fatir.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ سِرًّا وَعَلَانِيَةً يَرْجُونَ تِجَارَةً لَنْ تَبُورُ.
There are people who will be reciting, reading the Quran, the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They establish their prayer and they spend from that which Allah has provided them in secret as well as perhaps in open. And Allah says, they can expect a deal that will never deplete. Imagine only three things are made mention of here. Read the Quran, try and understand the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the book. Fulfill your salah and give your zakah. Give alms to the poor. Reach out to others. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the deal that you are striking with us, you will definitely have a profit that does not deplete. May Allah bless us. Imagine it seems and sounds so easy, but sometimes with us, we become weak to establish our salah, to read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to try and understand its meaning. It's not difficult. You know how what it takes from us nowadays? A little CD we can put into the vehicle whilst we're going to work and coming back, we can learn about the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But no, we choose to put in something else that will really liven up the energies within us that are heading in the direction of sin. That's what happens. You get heavy metal and everything else. The car is moving so badly that at the traffic light, you're wondering if there's an earthquake, you know, 4 on the Richter scale. You look next door and there's a young man doing this, you know, and the whole street is shaking. You know, subhanAllah, they told me that some of the boys have sound systems better than some of our masjids. It's a reality. Young boy tells me I spent 50,000 rands on my sound. And I looked at him and I said, at the masjid there, they've just got a loud hailer. Allahu Akbar. They'd rather hit a swap. SubhanAllah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us ease and goodness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, you want to do a deal? Remember, if you have a will, if there is a will, there is a way. The deal is there. We're open for it. You come, let's see, bring your product. And here you are. We will give you the reward. You will see the Prophet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then warns us, different type of a warning. Where he tells us, and this is obviously narrating that which will happen to the disbelievers and those who did not turn, even though they were given old age. Then death overtook them, they still didn't turn. So Allah says, there will be, you know, words between the different factions and so on. They will say, why has this happened to us and so on. And the answers will come about. So Allah says, we will tell them. Verse number 37 of the same surah, Surah Fatir. أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّذْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. Did we not give you life long enough for the one who wanted to take heed to take heed? And didn't we send the warner to you? Who is the warner? The warners are made up of so many categories. Firstly, the people, the messengers, the verses, and so on. And one of the tafsirs make mention of the gray hair. You grew old. You know, you clocked 40. Nowadays, at the age of 15, 16, they've already got gray hair. Allahu Akbar. But Allah says that gray hair is a warning to tell you, you're coming to us. Allahu Akbar. Allah says the gray hair you have is a warning just to tell you, hang on, you're now heading closer to us. You'd better turn. So Allah says, you have had gray hair, but you still didn't turn. Now what do you want from us? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And may he make us from those who take heed. And if you look at the next surah, which I'm sure we would all know almost off by heart, Surah Yasin, it's read regularly, mashallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that beautiful surah, which is powerful, but I'm picking one verse from it, verse number 65. Allah says regarding the day of judgment, الْيَوْمَ نَخْتِمُ عَلَىٰ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَتُكَلِّمُنَا أَيْدِيهِمْ وَتَشْهَدُ أَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. On that day we shall seal their mouths. We shall seal their mouths. Their hands and their legs will bear witness against them as to what they used to do. I'm serious, brothers and sisters. Look at your hand for a moment. Wallahi, without a joke, look at your nails. See, mashallah, you know, this hand will bear witness against you. When you touched something and, you know, you quenched your desire through the sense of touch, and your hand says, hey, why did you do that? I'm going to bear witness against you. Wallahi, it's a fact. And in another place in the Quran, Allah says, the skin will bear witness. Look at how beautiful you look, mashallah, your skin, you know, subhanallah. Like we said, even if there is a zit or two on the face, people cover it up with a foundation, subhanAllah. It's a reality. That piece of skin will bear witness against you. Believe me, let it be such that our hands bear witness for us. The hand will say, every day I was put down in sajda for you, O Allah. On the face, the head will say, every day this piece of skin was down on the ground. This is why the hadith says, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in sajda sometimes used to say, سجد وجهي للذي خلقه وصوره وشق سمعه وبصره بحوله وقوته. My head has prostrated on the ground for the one who created it, for the one who caused a slit where the eyes are so perfectly that they were flung open and I could see, for the one who made a hole in the ear so perfect that when it opened up I could hear. That is the one whom this entire head is on the ground for. Subhanallah. Powerful, powerful, my brothers and sisters. We put our head on the ground for who? The one who made it. No one else. So let us let our skin bear witness for us. When you look at your hand and you can say, Ya Allah, I have given charity with these hands. Ya Allah, I've made dua with these hands. Ya Allah, I have prostrated with these hands so many times a day. Ya Allah, forgive me if I have touched anything I was not allowed to touch, Ya Allah. How? Do you know when a person touches a bottle or he touches a non-mahram of the opposite sex, so on, the hands are actually yelling and screaming, please don't do this, don't do this. We can't hear it. We can't hear it. And the hand will come. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the person will ask his skin, وَقَالُوا لِجُلُودِهِمْ لِمَ شَهِدْتُمْ عَلَيْنَا. Why are you bearing witness against me? So they will say, or the organs of the body will say, do you know what? We are given the power to bear witness against you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave us the ability to speak out today. This is why we say, when your hair is uncovered and it is supposed to be covered, it is actually cursing you to say, please don't do this to me. It will bear witness against you to say, I wanted to be covered. And you know, the messages came 50 times, but still she didn't cover. Allahu Akbar. Imagine, we don't want that. Here the Quran is telling you, Surah Yasin, whenever you read the surah, look at your hand. And tell yourself, this hand must not bear witness against me. Then you've benefited from Surah Yasin. We read Surah Yasin so often, and a lot of us, we love the tune of it. It's not just a tune. Go and see the meaning of it. You want peace. You need to make sure that the peace is not only for the dunya where you follow your desires. If that's the case, you lose the peace here. But bigger than that, you lose the peace in the life after death. So brothers and sisters, this is the gift of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has warned us. And it's such a perfect reminder to say, you know what, your eyes, when you start looking at things that are wrong, your eyes will bear witness against you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never do that to us. But I want to give you the good news, my brothers and sisters. Engage in repentance and Allah wipes it out completely. Your hands will forget what bad was done. Your feet will be made to forget the bad places you walk to. Allah protect us. Imagine the ground, the earth, upon which a sin was committed, will get up and start talking. Yes, this is what happened. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us forgiveness and grant us the ability to turn to Him. The next surah is Surah Safat. In it, the opening verses, verse number 6, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of a beautiful gift of His. He says, إِنَّا زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِزِينَةٍ الْكَوَاكِبِ. We have indeed beautified the sky of this world with the beauty of the stars. The beauty of the stars. I want to pause there for a moment. My brothers and sisters, if you want peace, go out at night and look at the stars. You have so much comfort. Think of the power of Allah. Look at how they are. Read about the stars. Check how many light years away they are. What does that mean? Look at the distance, see the light, how much light is coming to us, yet that light was there perhaps 4 or 5 years ago, maybe more, in some cases thousands of years back, and we're only seeing it now. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us. So from this we learn that Allah has created for us so many things that just by looking at them we achieve peace. You know, the greenery, go out and see. Here in Cape Town we have some of the most beautiful scenes. Go out to Simonstown, perhaps to Hout Bay, perhaps somewhere else down there, you know, and take a drive and look at the scenery. Don't just look at it and say wow, say alhamdulillah, subhanallah. Look at the qudra of Allah. The mountains, take a look at what they look like, the waves, the ocean. All these creatures of Allah, they are there to bring about peace and serenity to your heart and mind with only one condition, to relate it to Allah. That's all. You look at it and relate it to Allah. It will bring about a soothing feeling. Look at the sky. Look at the sunrise, the sunset. All this, beloved creatures of Allah, is for you and me to look at and consider the greatness of Allah and achieve inner peace to say, that is my maker. فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. What the greatest of creators, subhanAllah, the creator, the only creator, Allahu Akbar, yet he is the best and he has made it in a perfect way. Imagine today, when you look at your own little child, you achieve a lot of coolness and comfort in your heart related to Allah. Ya Allah, you bestowed this child upon me. Ya Allah, you may take the child anyway, at any time. Look at the trees, look at the oceans, look at the animals, look at anything around you. If you relate it to Allah, you achieve a lot of comfort. This is why some people just go out and look at the scenery. And they enjoy it so much, whether it's the ocean or the greenery or the beautiful grass or the bush or whatever it is. Different people enjoy different things, you know. Some people are into this bonsai, you know, the little trees that you have, years old, and they are fascinated by it. They achieve so much comfort through it. Related to Allah, it will develop your iman as well. You become a strong mu'min just by looking at the creation of Allah, the stars, the moon, the sun, and everything else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is recognized through his creation. How great is he if he has already created something so big. Imagine the creator himself. La ilaha illallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us, and may he open the doors of goodness for us all. Until we meet again tomorrow, we say wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahi bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.